When you become a driver,
your whole point of view changes.
New responsibilities.
New things to think about.
One of the most important
might surprise you.
The test will be in 10 minutes. Break up into the groups I assigned and find a quiet spot to study.
I hate surprise tests.
What do we need to know?
It's all on fuel efficiency.
Well, we've covered a lot when you look at it, but it's probably good to start with the basics. Cars contribute to climate change by giving off carbon dioxide and other greenhouse gases.
And greenhouse gases are called that because they trap heat near the surface of the Earth, which makes temperatures go up.
Which changes climate conditions, and that could raise sea levels and cause flooding, damage crops, cause droughts.
Lead to pop quizzes.
Okay. Greenhouse gases also cause smog and air pollution, which contribute to health problems like asthma and heat stroke.
So those are a lot of problems. Then the next part is what to do about it. She'll ask about maintenance. We talked about that a lot. How to take care of your car so it's safe to drive and saves you fuel and money. There are little and easy things you can do regularly, like checking fluid levels and tire pressure. The important thing is to know your maintenance schedule and take your car to a professional mechanic for the complicated work.
But every car is different, so always read your owner's manual.
I remember she said something about tire pressure, about keeping them at the right level.
For safety and to save gas. I have it here. One tire underinflated by 8 psi, or 56 kilopascals, can lose 15,000 kilometers from its road life and increase the amount of gas you use by 4%.
Is it time already?
A few more minutes. Okay, we've done climate change, we've done maintenance. She's also going to ask about how you can drive for fuel efficiency and what you can drive to reduce emissions.
Oh, you know all about that last one, since you just finished car shopping.
It was very cool to walk into the dealership, knowing what questions to ask about the various options and all that.
Like what?
Well, the best ones for fuel efficiency were going for the smallest engine size that meets your everyday needs, going for an efficient transmission, which could be manual or automatic, depends on the make and the model. Like those CVTs, the continuously variable transmissions. They're automatic and they're efficient. What else? Getting two-wheel drive instead of all-wheel drive, cruise control, a block heater.
Didn't she say something in class about how power seats and doors make you use more gas? I didn't get that. They run off the battery.
They make the car heavier, though, because they have machine parts. When there's more weight to move, your engine has to work harder. Same with things that create drag, like sunroofs and roof racks.
Oh, yeah, okay. During my in-car the other week, Paul was saying how air conditioning also sucks gas. You should only use it on highways and that kind of driving. In the city, you should use your fans and vents. And, just don't wear shorts on vinyl seats on hot days.
I think the point is, every choice you make about your car can have an effect on fuel efficiency. Almost every choice.
When you're buying a vehicle, a new one anyway, you should look for the EnerGuide label. It tells you the fuel consumption rating and the estimated annual fuel cost. You can also find out about fuel consumption ratings from this guide, from Natural Resources Canada.
Did you look at alternative fuel vehicles at all when you were shopping for a car?
You mean hybrid vehicles that run on gas and electricity, like our instructor's car?
Man, I can't believe how quiet they are. When you're driving off the battery, you can barely hear the motor.
I can't wait for those fuel cell vehicles. No emissions at all from the tailpipe.
Someday. But really, there are some other great choices right now that can help you cut back on greenhouse gases, like ethanol-blended gasolines, or biodiesel, or natural gas.
So, what was the most interesting thing we learned on this topic?
You know what blew me away? How much carbon dioxide comes from every single liter of gas that gets burned. 2.4 kilograms for every liter of gas, 2.7 kilograms for diesel. That's crazy.
The one number that stuck in my head was the amount of extra gas drivers in Canada use every year because their tires aren't inflated properly.
It was like a million something.
It was 650 million. 650 million liters of fuel that get burned unnecessarily. Think about what Michelle was just saying, about how 1 liter of gas creates 2.4 kilograms of carbon dioxide. So if you have 650 million liters of fuel, that's, just a minute, 1.7 million tons of carbon dioxide. 1.7 million tons, that's totally avoidable.
That's unbelievable.
What? That much pollution? Or the fact that he could just do that math on paper like that?
So, Eric, what stuck most in your mind?
I don't know. I guess just that the way you drive makes such a big difference. Like, if you cut your highway cruising speed by just 10 kilometers an hour, it's safer, and you can save $3 on a $30 fill-up. Or how when you drive aggressively, stop-and-go style, it's not safe, and you end up burning way more gasoline. 39%. And if everybody in Canada cut back on idling by 5 minutes a day for a year, we could cut out more than 2 million tons of emissions. The 10-second rule. If you're going to be sitting for more than 10 seconds, shut her down.
So you were actually listening in there.
Yeah, I listened. I'm not stupid, you know. I get that this stuff, it's not all pointless. You can save yourself some money if you drive smart. And do other good things, too, at the same time.
You're right, Eric. Safe driving is good for you and the other drivers on the road. Not just because it helps you avoid collisions, but it's also better for the environment, which is better for everyone's health.
And our planet.
We should be getting back to class. It's almost time for the test.